I'd like to welcome you to Jerusalem. This could be one of the most exciting group of studies that we've ever brought to you. I am standing in the midst of old Jerusalem, inside its crenellated walls, and in an area that is known as the Jerusalem Citadel, also known as the Tower of David, and is a place very closely related to Herod in the time of his reign in this area. And there were three towers left in this area by the Romans, which showed the strength. They left them in order to show the strength of the city to those who would come after. In this special series of talks, we will be discussing with you at Jerusalem, the mystic city. We'll also be talking to you about empires die at Jerusalem. This is almost unique, and there is no other part of the world where you can say that various empires, Asian empires, Greek empires, empires that had to do with Europe, actually began their death in a certain city. It's a tremendous study, and I know that you will certainly enjoy it. We will also be talking to you about the genesis of Jerusalem, the beginnings of one of the most remarkable cities that man has ever had any knowledge of. We will be speaking about how Abraham inherited the city of Jerusalem, how God gave it to him and his seed after him. Then we will study Jerusalem by time periods so that you'll be able to see how it has developed. In this very ancient area in which we're standing at the present time, it takes you so far back into history until you begin to feel how ancient this area really is. And it has a voice, a living voice, that wishes to talk to the people of our times. And that's the purpose of these special talks. In Psalm 132, verses 13 and 14, it says, Jehovah hath chosen Zion. That's a remarkable statement. He has desired it for his habitation. That's a more remarkable statement. This is my rest forever, if you can imagine it. Here will I dwell, for I have desired it. Those words happen to be in your Bible, too. It'd be interesting for you to survey them and to get the feeling of actually what they mean. Our world in which we live today, from the beginning of empires, has refused to recognize Jerusalem as a capital city. I want you to accept that and to think of it very strongly. Jerusalem has never been a capital city, excepting for the nation of Israel. No one, no nation, no people have ever elevated Jerusalem as being a valuable city, a capital city, excepting the nation of Israel. Jerusalem as a city could truthfully be called the world's greatest orphan. It has been passed on from empire to empire, from nation to nation, who have pranced through this city thinking that they own it, when God himself had already designed who should own it, and man's equivocations absolutely meaningless and amounts to nothing. Our generation must know that from all history, the Jews have never left Jerusalem voluntarily. Now that you must know. They have always been forced out, or chased out, or hounded out, or shut out, but they have never walked out on their capital city. Please remember that and let it, you know, become very deeply embedded in your spirit. I presume that the Believe It or Not of Ripley fame has no rival with the strange fortunes of possibly the strangest city on planet Earth, and that city is Jerusalem. Jerusalem is not just stones, as I am surrounded by such ancient stones. The rocks, the streams of religious zealots, are prancing generals of history. To walk through Jerusalem streets is actually to walk the pathway of the history of mankind, because most history has walked through this city. Never has there been a city so like this city. Inside these walls, you find the enmity of deity and devils. That makes it the strangest city on the face of this earth. War never ends, never terminates in a city called peace, a city that has seldom seen peace for any length of time in all of its amazing history. Clouds of hate, clouds of suspicion, clouds of misunderstanding hang low over the walls of Jerusalem, not for your generation only, but for the total generations of mankind for 3,000 years. That makes it a city that all of us should study about. We should seek to understand it. We should seek to know it. It will take a little time and perseverance, but all of us should rise up and say, here's a city that I must know more about than I've ever known before. Jerusalem is Earth's unique city. It's where heaven's greatest love was expressed and displayed on the summit of a little hill close by here called Calvary, where God told the world that I love mankind, and the Savior of the world expressed to the world that he loved mankind and gave his life that it might be blessed. Jerusalem is a city where the ancient past meets the trembling present and forebodes the apocalyptic future. That's truly Jerusalem. And if you can't take the three into your spirit and have some comprehension and understanding of them, you'll never know what Jerusalem is all about. If you give some thought to Jerusalem, you will discover that it is the birthplace of ideas. It's the birthplace of events. And these events shape world destiny. Yes, it was the Ten Commandments that came from this city, and no other city has ever produced such a word to direct mankind. And it was in this city that the people that you call the church was born, and from this city spread out to the ends of the earth. There's never been a city like the city of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is so very closely related to my own personality. I've taken human beings for many years to many parts of the world. I've taken great tour groups to the Orient, to Africa, and to all kinds of places. But I have taken more people to Jerusalem than any other place on planet Earth. Besides Americans, I have taken Chinese. They wanted to see it so badly. I've taken Filipinos from the Orient. I've taken many Europeans. I've taken Africans. And of course, many Americans to visit the world's most amazing city. And so I have a very close relationship to it in that my family and I lived in Jerusalem at one time during the Sinai War for 6 or 7 months. And during that time, our sons went to school here and I studied here, and we walked the streets of this amazing city to seek to find out, what caused it to be the amazing, remarkable, enigmatic city that it actually is. Through the Sinai War, we were here, and through its last great war, the Yom Kippur War, I had a group of about 67 people, and we were here for the total war. The day we left was the day the war completed. And so we have a very close relationship with Jerusalem and the people of Jerusalem. Yes, our sons have gone to school here. I've walked its walls late at night and prayed. I have watched the brilliant sunlight as it would come up over the hills of Moab and skip over the Dead Sea and awaken Jerusalem to a new day. I've sat watching sunrises, praying from Mount Zion, asking God to bless the remarkable and amazing place called Jerusalem. It's amazing to me that this city should have the name it has. The place of peace. Think of it for a moment, please. So many times a city lives up to its name. It is what its name indicates, you know. But this city, which means peace, there's been no spot on this globe that's had more tears, more heartaches, more bloodshed, more broken homes, more devastation than the city of Jerusalem has known in its history. It has been besieged by tyrants. It has been inflamed by riots. It has been ruled by the lowest and the meanest of intrigue through its amazing history that has come down to us. Jerusalem's remarkable crenellated walls that are so beautiful at night with the lights upon them have been splashed with more human blood than maybe any other city on the face of our earth. Its meandering streets that take you down through the various areas of the city, the Muslim area, the Christian area, the Jewish area of here, these meandering streets resound of marching legions of times past. Generation after generation, the inhabitants of the city have seen the war gear of the mighty nations of the world with its prancing horses dance through their streets, only to dance into oblivion. This history all began with a man named Abraham. A man who came up out of the east from here, 500 or 600 or 700 miles over the way, and God told him that these barren hills, which may not have been barren at that time, could be his and his seed after him. And beginning from the time that he came up out of the Ur of the Chaldees into this, at that time, unknown spot to dwell there, there came a divine relationship to this city and the God that created all things and that made all things. Until 400 years after that time, when God gave him this area, the first Israeli marching army under Joshua came marching into the land out of Egyptian bondage, and they possessed what to them was called the Holy Land, and Jerusalem was to be its mighty center, its beautiful center. Jerusalem, as the Bible says, is a compact city. Its ancient walls enclose only 215 acres, yet there's more pertinent human history recorded in those 215 acres than any other 2 square miles on the face of planet Earth. Yes, Jerusalem is about the size of Central Park in New York City. And in that very limited area, so much of the history of mankind has transpired. No history, no city has contributed to so much history as the city of Jerusalem in all of mankind's histories. It makes it truly an exciting story, because you find it a city to be indestructible. You knock it down and up it comes again. It is a city that's imperishable. Kill off the inhabitants and their children will move back in. And so it is a city unlike any other. It has the mightiest influence of cities among all the cities of the world in which we live. It's possible. And when Abraham came into this area, the Bible says that Melchizedek was a king and a priest when he arrived. Now, Abraham was only 10 generations removed from Noah. And each one of us represents 5 generations. I knew my grandfather, I knew my father, I know myself. I know my son, who has his hand on the camera right now, and his son, that is my grandson. So every one of us understands 5 generations. There were only 2 of those from Noah to Abraham. There was no lost period of time. There was no darkness. There was no ignorance. People knew one another. Just 2 time periods between Noah and Abraham. And in that time, Jerusalem became the ruling place of Melchizedek, that the Bible says was without beginning or days or end of life, and without father or mother, that he was a priest under the Most High God. You don't know too much about him in history. But he was already reigning here, and Abraham came here and paid tithes unto this remarkable person who was a king, a ruler, and also that he was a priest. And so there was a city here. God promised it to the seed of Abraham. But there was a city here when he arrived. 400 years later, when they came back, the Jebusites ruled. And so Joshua had to remove them from the place so he could occupy the place that God had promised him. And only David came and made it the first royal city of the people of Israel. And from that day until this day, it has been the royal city in the heart of every Jew that ever lived. It has never ceased to be their royal city. Whether they were here or whether they were absent, this was their royal city. Whether they were in peace or at war, this was also always their royal city that they loved and cared for. Geographically, Jerusalem is a meeting place. Jerusalem is a meeting place of the east and the west. It's a meeting place of the north and the south. It's the joining of continents. It joins itself, the Holy Land joins itself with Europe, and it joins itself with Africa, and it joins itself with the Mediterranean Sea, and joins itself with Asia. And so it is the meeting place of the entire world. One of the most exciting things about Jerusalem is that its altitude of 2,550 feet makes it the highest important capital city in the history of mankind. Although there's Lhasa in Tibet and La Paz in Bolivia, but I mean a capital city like Babylon or like Shushan, the Persians, or like Athens, or like Rome, or like London, or Paris, or New York, or Washington. Jerusalem is the highest elevation city, capital city, in mankind's history. This seems a very, well, it's a unique situation, as it is definitely the highest capital city that the world has ever known. And in this city, even today, is where the past, where the present meets the past, and it predicts the future, and it tells you about tomorrow. It is a most remarkable place in that it the present meets the past, predicts the future, and yesterday meets tomorrow, and they do it today. That's all the conundrum that makes this the amazing city. This city is precious to God. This city is precious to man. Jerusalem is the bride of kings. Jerusalem is the mother of prophets. When we read in the book of Isaiah, in chapter 43 and verse 5, it says, "Fear not, I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east and gather thee from the west." Please notice the wording that God spoke prophetically at that time. He says, "I will bring thy seed from the east." This actually meant something like force, you know, from Iran, from Iraq, from the east. The people of Israel were compelled to come. They were robbed before they come. They came into the area penniless, you know. Their treasures were taken from them. But it also says, and gather them from the west. Now, from America, you don't find immigrants to Israel in great numbers, for the simple reason that life is still hard. It's still a nation at war. It's still in a nation that's imperiled by 100 million enemies. And so you don't find a lot of people just, you know, deliberately coming. Those that do come almost have to come. And so God, through Isaiah, said, "I'll bring your seed from the east. I'll gather them from the west." Isn't it amazing how correct, how perfectly correct? But listen to what it says in verse 6. It says, "I will say to the north, give up." That's Russia. They haven't given up completely yet. There's several million Jews that live in the ironclad dictatorship behind that iron curtain that must be released some way. It cannot be forever. They must be released, you see. And God says, "I will say to the north, give up." Now, this doesn't say that Israel will say, the United Nations will say, or America will say. God says, "I'm going to say it." And when God speaks like thunder, and when he hits that great communist land, they'll know that they give up. And at that time, the seed of Israel will return. It will return unto this land. And then in verse 6, it also says, "And I will say to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the ends of the earth." I would like to tell you that no human person could have spoken those words without a divine intelligence flowing through them. Now, you know that yourself. You've got to, you know, accept that. A person living 700 years B.C. Could not have spoken of things 2,000 2,000 years A.D. You see, it is not possible unless it was divinely inspired, unless God has his hand upon this amazing city of Jerusalem. But now, in this introduction to Jerusalem that I am giving you at the present time, with the donkeys having their little tea party outside, with this amazing introduction that we're giving you, that Jerusalem is a city where empires die. And as we go into this, you're going to be more amazed than ever before that there has never been an empire that has ruled the world that didn't get sucked by some invisible force into the cauldron of this city, only to touch it and die. Now, I will mention several times that the last Arab mayor, the last Jordanian mayor of the city of Jerusalem, on the day that he left town in a hurry before the Israeli army was moving in, that his final words were these: Jerusalem is a golden bowl full of vipers. Yeah, it is a golden bowl. For some reason, every empire wants to control this city. I was looking a few moments ago where Wilhelm had to come here. He had to ride through these walls in a chariot. They had to remove the stone so he could ride through these walls in great strength and power. You know, Wilhelm of Germany. And before him, Alexander the Great couldn't keep himself away from this city. Yeah, within him was a desire to conquer, and he had to put his fingers upon this city. Babylon had to do the same. Egypt, although she was not a world empire, was an area empire, and she felt it was necessary for her to do this. And so there has never been a mighty power, and the subtitle of this group of lessons is, Will America Die at Jerusalem? Yeah. When I read to you the telegram that I sent to our present president, you will be amazed at the words that I told him regarding his decisions that he makes about this city. You know, for 3,000 years, people have been making decisions about this city. But man cannot make those decisions. They've already been made by someone superior to him. And anything that he says are really idle words. And surrounded by the most historic stones on the face of this earth, seated inside of David's tower in the ancient city of Jerusalem, I can speak to you and tell you of assurance that God has his hand in the affairs of man, in the affairs of nations, in the affairs of families, in the affairs of human persons, that whoever you are, you are not a leaf being blown by a wind. You're not a boat that's adrift without a rudder. There is direction in every human life. We have a God up there that's big and mighty and all-powerful. And to resist him is the greatest act of foolishness in the human life. And yet, our planet Earth, that's about all it knows, is resistant to the plan of God. And in this moment, with the United Nations pulling one direction and Russia pulling almost the same direction and America trying to another direction, and the focal part of the whole earth is Jerusalem. It's Jerusalem. No, it's not New York City, nor London, nor Paris, nor Berlin, nor Moscow. It's right where I'm looking at you at this moment. It's the mystic city of Jerusalem. The more you learn about it, the more clever you are. It's not an easy situation to become acquainted with, but the more you learn about it, the more you understand what's going on in the world today. You can't understand the Arab situation, the Jewish situation, the Russian situation, until you come to know what God has ordained for this area of the world. Oh, it would be so good for you to know it and to learn it and to come to understand it. And it might give you a better comprehension of your own self, you know? Yeah, of your own self. And especially of your understanding of the world news. Yeah. Most of it is given to you by people that have no comprehension of history. They only see a thing a minute at a time, you know. You got to see more than that in the world that we live today. I'm sitting in the midst, you might say, the history of mankind from Abraham until now. Just a few steps over here is where Abraham came to offer his son, Isaac, and where God spoke to him. And where the Lord Jesus said, Abraham saw my day, and he was glad. I'm sitting in the very citadel of the history of mankind, seeking to help you to find a way through your life and your times in which you live. Because to understand this can certainly get you to understand destiny and eternity and the things that really mean something to the human race. I urge you to give more thought than ever before. I urge you to give prayers as never before. The Bible says pray for the peace of Jerusalem. If there was ever a time that it needed it, it's today. Because you see, when we speak of this city, we actually speak of a nation. We don't speak of a Jerusalem town. This city represents a nation. It represents a race. It represents a destiny.